All right, I've come over here into the wood shop and I'm getting ready to start sheath making. And my sheaths start with paper patterns, a lot like the way my knives start out. So all I've done here is I've just struck a nice straight line. It doesn't have to be square to the paper or anything. You just want to make sure you've allowed enough paper to put your full pattern on there. So starting with the full tang version of the knife, I just want to lay the knife down to where that center line runs with the spine of the knife. And then without letting it scoot around too much, because you know this is leather work, it's not super exact, but you do want to kind of keep the knife in that place and just roll her over on her side, just like that. And since I'm going to wet form this sheath and it's going to kind of tightly form to here, I do give it just a little bit of extra, just like that. And then all I do is I trace the outline of the knife, and I've already done that. And then I take a compass, set it about an inch out, and that just gives me plenty. And I'll just, starting at about here, I'll just trace the knife around, and I've already done that too. And that just shows me where the outer part of my sheath's going to go. Now, I'll be bringing this line in closer to the knife, but I just wanted to make sure I have enough. This is the important outline. This is going to form the edge of a piece of the sheath called the welt. And what the welt does, it does a few things. One, as the knife goes into the sheath, it's going to form the cam that's going to help lock that knife into place. Now, the welt will be straight right here. We will not have a cutout for the finger groove. That's just going to get in the way. But a part of the welt will extend past this hump right here, just about like that. And so the knife will get down in there and kind of lock into a groove that we make for it. And another thing the welt does, it's going to be a third layer, and it's going to protect the stitching from this cutting edge. And the other thing that a welt does is add stiffness and strength so the sheath won't flex so much. So if you happen to fall and bend it, the knife is not liable to come through the sheath at the point because it just simply won't bend it and allow it to do that. So yeah, it's a pretty important piece. So right now, we're pretty much into freehand stuff, and I have determined I want about half the knife handle to come up out of the sheath when it folds over, and that's just enough to get your fingers on. Okay, I've got my pencil line drawn out and cut out. So now what I do, I've already folded this over, and I transferred this over to this side, and looking at it this way, this is a right-handed sheath, or it's going to be. So what has to happen is this is the flap that's going to have to fold over. So what I do now is I just cut off this part and I lay it back over, and then I transfer this line over to here. I'll cut that out, and this is my tab that's going to go up, fold over, and become the belt loop. And so when I get this part cut out, I'll determine my belt loop finish length and all of that. And then I will lay all of this onto a clean, uncut piece of paper, trace it back out, and that'll become my whole pattern. But you do kind of have to hack these up. Another thing I'm going to have to do after I transfer this is I'm going to have to cut this piece out that you see laid out right here, and that's going to be my weld portion. So we're going to get snipping and get the drawing a little bit, and we'll come back when we're ready to lay it out on the leather itself. Okay, I have my pieces cut out. Here they are. So this is going to become my permanent pattern, and I use pretty heavy-duty cardstock, and if I'm careful with it, I won't tear them up. I just keep them in the back cover of that big book and just protected. So anyway, I've already written up for left on the wrong side. So now what I'm doing, this step depends on the kind of leather that you buy. And every now and again, Tandy Leather will run these double shoulders on special. Now, the reason they're on special, and here it is, they have what's called range marks on them. Range marks, essentially, are scars. you know, from whatever source, bug bites, just maybe in a fight with another cow, scraping themselves against something. I've even seen brands on these, but they are, they're just blemishes in the leather. So what we want to do is we want to avoid areas with real bad range marks. And on some areas, if the range marking isn't so horrible, I could go over that and kind of conceal it with some tooling, basket weave or just whatever. So there's not a whole lot of waste. You have to dig through the step when you go buy this stuff and just make sure you get something that, you know, that you're going to be able to use. So before I flip the leather over, because you always lay out leather, I do anyway, for the Nietzsche's with the suede side up. So we're going to look at the top grain side. And some small range marks like this, I'm not too worried about. In fact, I can even kind of make this the back side of the sheath. So this is going to be the back of the sheath. So if I wanted to do something like that, because here I can see that I have good unblemished leather here. I'm looking over here. You know, I don't want to come way out here and cut something. I want to kind of conserve my leather, obviously. So don't have anything bad here, so I'm going to call that right there my piece for this sheath. So now I'm just going to flip my leather over. But you do have to watch out for the range marks. Now, if you buy the really nice double shoulders and sides, things like that, and bends, you don't have to worry about it, because there isn't any blemishes on it. And the stuff I buy, unfortunately, which is the economy leather, you know, it's what we have to put up with. I'm just double checking myself. So yeah, I'm happy with that. Now this leather is going to be dyed and worked, so I just want to bring it up as close to the edge as I can, and I don't want a whole lot of waste. But then I just take a Sharpie, and again, suede side up, and my left hand notation is always down, and I don't have any bad surprises. Sharpie makes a nice little fine mark that's easy to follow. Now for my weld section, I'll come over here to the edge, and you can kind of see there where I've cut one out on a previous knife. But I just kind of keep that as close to the edges of my leather as possible. All right, so we're ready to cut this out. I just have one of those HDPE type cutting boards that we all have seen, and probably all of us have. And I have found the easiest thing to cut leather out is this old linoleum knife. I've got a pretty keen edge on it. So I just take this is just a strop that I've put rouge on. And I just give it a few strokes. That's really all it takes. And then just using this as a backer, you can begin just anywhere you want. I just punch down through, and then I don't try to go all the way through on one cut. I just pull it gently and get a score going that I can easily follow with another pass. And it generally takes two passes. I don't want to try to do it in one cut, because if it sticks and then the knife slips, you know, there goes a piece of leather that I could have used for something else. So yeah, just haste makes waste in this case. I've got my piece cut out. I've got my tab formed about like it's going to go for my belt loop. Now, I just bring my old scrap pattern or sacrificial pattern back over, and all I'm going to do is just that's going to get an idea of where my center line of the sheath is going to be. So here's the basic idea, and this is why we traced our center line. What we're going to do is we're going to cut a hinge, basically, and we're going to relieve some of the leather on this back side, and I just use a small V chisel for that. They call it a veiner. A lot of different names for these. But just something very small and nice and sharp. And I just want to cut a small channel and relieve some of the pressure. And you don't go very deep on this 10 ounce. this is probably about 3/16 thick, roughly, something like that. But you might want to go a third of its depth. Just watch your cut. Don't go all the way through, or this is, you know, a dog chew at that point. But I just, all the way to the edge, all the way to this edge. And what's that? What that's going to do is get the material out of the way and allow me to fold it and not let the leather want to crack right here where you're stretching the outer top grain section. And it's going to be cased before we do anything else. That encased means basically we're just going to wet it. So I like to use saddle soap when I case. It makes the leather nice and supple. It puts a lot of the oils and things back into the leather that the tanning process took out. And this is vegetable tanned leather. I just get a sponge soaked up with some water and just get some saddle soap on it. And then just start scrubbing it in at this point. I want the leather workable, and I don't want to have to fight it, and I want to put the oils and the, just some of the suppleness back into it. I don't rinse the saddle soap out. It doesn't hurt a thing to stay in this leather. Okay, this is dried to the point where I can start working it again. And so the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to do some edging. I just want to hone my little edging tool. If you do this with all your different cutting tools before you use them, you'll get a good result, and it'll be sharp the next time you go to use it too. So where I want to edge right now is all the areas where I'm not going to be stitching. I don't worry about this area because that is going to be all finished and edged after we stitch the sheath together. But I can go ahead and get these areas here where there isn't going to be any stitching. So I'm just going to finish my edging out to the corner right here, and then we stop. We do the inside portion as well. And I always stop and just take a few strokes on the strop and get it sharp again. And just keep your tool pressed in firmly. And you'll get a nice even bevel. Just like that. Now I'm going to dye the leather. I get all these steps done and out of the way before I actually start punching and stitching. So the steps in order are going to be dyeing, and I dye it inside and out and dye the edges. I'll have to re-dye after I dress this, but I dye the face of the leather. I want this stuff to soak in. This is a combination stain and finish, and it really does a nice job. It buffs up a lot like shoe polish, actually. So with this dye, as the instructions say to do, you want to try to get a good even coat the first time you go at it. So don't concentrate your dye on one area, just try to cover the whole thing. And then if you want to go over it again when you're finished with this, well, you certainly can. Let's take a little rubbing stick here. And I've got different size grooves cut in this. I made this over on the wood lathe. It's cherry. But you just want to start polishing your beveled edges. Do it now while it's moist, and then there's actually a compound that we use to do a final finish. It makes it nice and hard. This is the stuff I use to burnish the edges and the suede side, and I'll let you work with pronouncing that second part. It's gum, I got that. Anyways, that's what I use, and it does a good job. All right, now it must dry just a little bit more, so we can go ahead and take our weld piece and lay it in there. with some cement, and then we'll fold the whole thing. Now that it's dried to this point, I'm going to go ahead and take my veiner, and you can start at either end. It really doesn't matter. You can use something to guide your tool if you want, but you know, this is not real precise. You can eyeball this. And as always, before you cut with something, let's go ahead and give it a stropping on the hone. And that's all you want to do, is right about like that. Just get you a furrow started that you can follow. Just like that. It's easier going this way than trying to come in from the raw edge. And then just keep an eye on your line. And I says, as I said, arrow straight is not critical here. What is critical is don't go too deep. You never want to see the corners of your veining tool get below the surface of leather. If you do, then you're going too deep. But you want to carry it all the way out to the edge, just like that. So that's pretty much it. And the leather is going to follow that area right there, and it's going to fold over. And you kind of get an idea of what our sheath's going to look like when she's all finished. I'm getting ready to start gluing the belt loop tab down, and I went ahead and made my groove on the back side to help me form my hinge. And what I did is I just laid it down and then just gently made a mark around there. So then all it is to show me where to put my rubber cement. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come across here and there with stitching, and that's going to be strong enough to hold that for quite some time. And what I did is I allowed enough room to put a good heavy inch and a half belt, maybe an inch and five-eighths belt, through this belt loop, which I feel like is going to be wide enough. So anyway, another thing that I did, I went ahead and cut the weld down. I cut it out a little heavy. I laid the weld down, making sure that I had hangover all the way down, and then I traced a line, because I'm going to cement this on after we get this stitched, and I want to be able to finish all these edges together, and I want the weld to be proud of that, those two edges, rather than recessed. You got to be careful about that. And we only ask it to do its thing for just a little while until the stitching takes over. But this is just to hold the pieces. So the only thing you really want to be careful about here is not get outside of your layout, because you don't want rubber cement residue on the outside of the leather. It will leave a little bit of a trace. So you just want it there, and then you want it on the back side of this. And it doesn't take very long for this rubber cement to kind of haze over. As soon as it loses its sheen, it's ready to stick one part to the other, and it takes a pretty good bite. Okay, my heater's lighting off. That's the noise you hear in the background. All right, this has been clamped up for a good 10 minutes. We can take that off. So now I'm just going to take a grooving tool, and I'm just going to trace my outline and just give a furrow for those stitches to get into. Just enough to get them subsurface. Now we're going to pull the stitches tight, so they're going to burrow down in there pretty well. I had to have several stitching punches here. This one cuts six at a time. So I just want to kind of get that lined up. And what I do is I just take the other one and kind of see where I'm going to end up. And I just have a piece of black granite down here to provide some mass, and I just take my punch just down like that, and you want to hold your piece down and pull your lacer out. Then we want to take it to the corner, so just put that one in there on our last hole to line it up. then we can start into our radius. And on a curve like this, it depends on the severity of the curve. I usually just take my time and just go two holes at a time around a pretty sharp curve. All right, now that I have a layout on the back side, I'm going to do the same thing and cut a groove, just connecting the dots, so to speak. And then we'll come back when we have it over there on the other bench to do the stitching. So, yeah, just one little step at a time. All right, ready to start stitching now. And what I use is just a hand stitching awl. And I have different colors of thread on different bobbins, or different spools, rather. And these stitching awls come with a little bobbin that fits inside this hollow handle. And the idea is you load your thread onto that, and you put it in there, and there's a cap. But one thing I have found is on long seams, you have to be careful you don't run out of thread in mid-job, and that has happened to me. And then you just pull all the thread out and you start over. So in order to get around that, what I've done is I've just done away with the little bobbin that fits inside of here, and I run my thread straight from the large spool here, and I just have that on a dowel rod, just in a hole drilled into the side of my bench, and I have a hole on either side depending on what side of the work I'm working from. But yeah, that way I know that I'm not going to run out of thread. So what you do, you just find your beginning and push your awl through. All right, and as you pull the awl out, it'll make a loop just like that, and you catch it with something. I'm just going to use a finish nail here. But now you want to pull your awl all the way out, and then you want to pull your thread through just like that. Now here's the trick to it. You want to make sure you pull enough thread out to go all the way around your stitch, because this forms your lock stitch. So I like to pull a lot of excess. So if I figure all that up, I probably have close to 4 inches of total stitch. So I want to pull out enough just to be sure. This thread is fairly cheap. It's a good nylon waxed thread. It's tough stuff. And the wax thread's important. One, to make it easier to pass through the leather, and two, it holds itself kind of stiff, so you don't need to thread this through another needle. So the idea, you just pick the way you want to go. It's not really important which way you go. And you just find your next hole, pass your awl through, and then I keep my palm against the awl to hold tension on my thread. They have this little peg here that you wind it around that helps you do that, but I always just lock it in place. And it makes sure that I pull the thread tight from the last hole. Now, just retract just a little bit and watch for the loop to show. There's your loop right there, so you just want to pass your thread through that loop and hold it, and hold it pretty tightly, and then go ahead and pull your awl back out. And then at this point, you just want to pull tightly on both pieces to make sure that your loop has pulled back inside, and that forms a lock stitch. But then you pull it back out again, there's your other loop, pass through, pull, hold it tight, withdraw your needle. At that point, I just grab actually the thread at the end of the awl and just pull it tight, and you've made another lock stitch. And then it's just repeating the process all the way around. Kind of boring, but it is kind of relaxing too. All right, I've come to the end of my stitch. I'm back at the beginning hole, and then all I do is I stitch backwards from here about 5 stitches or so. So there we go with that. And I'm going to grab this little scissors here and just cut off my excess. Now, before I cut my excess off my stitching awl, I always pull some extra out just to be set up for the next run. So that is that. And this just little jig I made to hold the leather work has leather jaws, and I've broken the corners of them so they don't make an impression in the leather. So that's what you end up with. So now I'm going to take, right here on my work surface, I'm just going to take a rawhide face mallet. And all I'm doing is hammering my stitches flat. So that's it. So now we can proceed to gluing our weld in, and then getting those holes punched and stitching that. And then we're wet forming the sheath, and we're done with this one. But I did want to take you through all the steps to make one sheath. I won't show you making the one for the hidden tang. It's going to be virtually the same sheath. But yeah, Chuck, old BRATTrider, asked me if I would show some of the steps to stitching and making a sheath. So yeah, we'll come back when we're stitching the main stitching line here. And that's going to be about it. I'm getting ready to glue the weld in. But just on both sides, I'm just coming back here, a heavy quarter of an inch, and I'm just cutting it down to a little bit of a wedge shape so that leather doesn't have a real sharp corner to break around. I've got my line laid out where I want the edge of my weld to come into. So we're just going to lay some glue down. And again, the only thing this cement is supposed to do is hold this in place while we punch our holes and stitch. And then its job is kind of done. Anyway, I'm just going to take this rotary punch and just come right to where the point of the knife is, right about there, and then just knock a hole through it. And now we have a nice, neat little drainage hole. If I can get that off of there. There we go. That's just to let water shed out, and it's right at the bottom of the well where the water's liable to stand. Because we pull these seams tight enough, this thing will hold water. I suppose you might think that the rubber cement adds some sort of weatherproofing to the seam, but really what does that is the neat's foot oil we saturate these sheaths with when they're constructed. I buy neat's foot oil by the gallon. Get it at Tractor Supply for about $16 a gallon. That's not bad. That's just started hazing. This stuff dries pretty fast. I have my shop heater on, so it's fairly warm in here. So now, or line up my edges. And remember that I left this sticking out, so I don't want to try to bring this edge flush with this. I can set back just a little bit, and I'll still be okay. And we can just clamp as we go. There we are. And you just work your way down the line with your clamps. Alright, clamps come off now. Looks like that's stuck pretty well. Now I'm going to dress this down real quick till everything's flush on the belt sander, and we'll be right back. Alright, we got it dressed off. And we've got a nice even line. So now's the time we just want to take our edger and finish our edges down here. Just give it a beveler. I call it an edger. Some people call it a bevel tool. I'm not a leather worker. I make sheaths. So I'm going to get some of these terms wrong. But you get the idea. You take this thingy and you knock that raw edge down. Now just keep the guide against the edge of your leather and pull. You see that makes a nice, neat stitching groove. And there we go. I take them right off the edge on that side. All right, we're going to do the same as before. We're going to take our punches and go down through, and that's going to give us a series of holes to follow on that. Okay,
wanted to hurry up and get out of that last segment over in the other bench because I looked up and saw my battery light flashing. So I went ahead and got this in here. And since our holes are punched and we have one thread through, I'm not really worried about this coming apart now because it's starting to delaminate just a little bit, but our holes are punched, they're a little lined up, so it's going to pull it back in line. So I went ahead and pushed my awl through, got my thread, and now what I'm doing, they tell you generally when you're stitching two pieces of leather, and I think the directions I read were for like 6 ounce leather or something like that. This is 10 ounce, it's thicker, and there are three layers. So they tell you generally to go twice the length of your stitch, but I'm going to go 5 times the length of my stitch. So I'm going to call that 2 just for good measure, because I don't want to run out of stitch on this side for my lock stitch. As I said, this thread is cheap, and I'd rather waste a little bit of it. And this stuff is wax that's peeling off here as it goes to the needle. I'd rather waste a little bit of thread than have to redo the whole thing. I want plenty. So that's going to be about good there. And that's just a matter of, well, the same as we did for our belt loop. Just find your hold. Get that pushed in. And in each stitch you do, it's going to pull these in line. Go at the end of your thread, poke it through, and you can see now that this is not a spectator sport. So pull that back out, and we tie our first lock stitch. And before I chuck this thing up in here, I went ahead and cut my back groove too for my stitching. So we're good to go there. Too many times I have looked up in the middle of videoing something only to see that the camera battery had died. So, all right, push through, and then it's just more of the same. And honestly, if you stick with it and get a rhythm started, it'll take you about 10 minutes to get down to the end of this stitch. So I'm going to shut the camera off. I'm going to come back when we have this stitch complete, and then the next step is going to be burnishing and dyeing this raw edge, and then we're wet forming. And we'll be wrapped up with this. I wanted to show you one little point about this hand stitcher. One side of the needle has a groove in it for the thread to lay in as you push through the hole. So when you pull back, most of the time it is the correct side that will form a loop. Sometimes both sides will bow out a little bit when you retract the needle. If you're in doubt, the side of the needle with the groove, that's the thread you do not thread through with your lock stitch thread. You always want to go to the other side. So if both of them come out and form that little eye right there, that loop, just look under the thread. If you see the needle groove, go to the other one. If you go through this one, you're just going to have to undo that one stitch and go back one and start again. That's an important little point. It can get you. All right, we've gotten to the end, and we're just going to do our back stitching now to lock everything in. We're going to go back about 5 stitches. So that's it to this point. We're going to get this excess wax cleaned up off of here, and we'll come back for the wet forming. The sheath basically is done except for the fine tuning, which is wetting it and getting the knife in there, molding the leather to the knife, and then finishing this edge. I've got a little more dress sanding to do. I find that when you stitch, it kind of, when it squeezes it, it makes that welt come out just a little bit more, but we just take that one run down the belt sander, and that'll get that nice and finished, and then we'll burnish, wet form, burnish everything again, move on to the next sheath, and then this one is done. Okay, we just finished our edge, and we're applying just a little bit of dye to it again. And then once I get this on here, this dye
has an oil, a conditioner in it, and that is when I take the stick. You notice this stick has different size grooves, and that's for your different layers of leather. For a triple layer, I go up to this biggest groove, and you just want to rub it while it's still kind of wet, and this dries it out pretty fast, but it gets everything down to a nice smooth finish, makes it hard. So this is just preforming it a little bit with the rubbing stick. This is just a test fit, and when it gets down, I can feel it hitting that cam. There it goes, and it just cammed in. Now when we wet form that, you won't have to fight the knife in and out of the sheath. But that's what it's going to look like when it's all finished up. Next day, Monday evening, and we're getting ready to wet form the sheath. And all we did, went into the kitchen and just ran some fairly hot water, not scalding, and just filled it up and then ran it on the outside. And it's supple, but it's not soaking wet. You don't want to get it soaking wet. And then it's pretty simple. You just insert your knife, and you want to go in slowly and form it as it goes in, and make sure we catch our cam in the right spot, and then make sure your knife spine is straight to the weld. They can twist on you, so just be careful, and then get her all the way down. You can feel it locked into that cam, and then at this point, you just start forming your knife to the sheath. It's kind of doughy, and it will hold its shape. And it's just a slow process, but this is what really kind of customizes your sheath, you know, to the knife that you've made it for. Then right here where the belt loop's going to be, while it's still kind of wet, I just push my, I call that my belt form in there. Just kind of get a little pocket formed in that. And this leather will hold its shape pretty well after this forming process. You can do away with that and see how that pocket got formed in there in that belt loop. And that'll stay. That'll stay like that. That's it. That is basic wet forming. So we're going to pop the knife out of there. I don't have to worry about this coming back into its original shape. The leather is nice. It's very pliable. And like I said, when you do this step, that's when you you really mate the knife to the sheath and they become a pair. All right, now we're going to go ahead and get started on the other one. You can get this knife wiped down and just put a little coat of beeswax on it just to keep it, because there's moisture in there now, so I want to keep any kind of discoloration from forming. This is going to go into the dehydrator, and we'll get started on the sheath for the hidden tang version. That is Sheath Making 101. Just wanted to show you some of the steps. And I wasn't going to, but old BRATTrider Chuck, he made a comment that led me to believe maybe I ought to include a little bit of the steps in the sheath making process, at least how I do it, for some of you guys that might want to make one. So that's just one way, but it does work out pretty well. So we're going to carry on, and we will see you in the next roundup, which is going to be showing you everything finished up.